Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome back. And today I'm going to talk about, inshallah, about chirality and how it affects abiogenesis, or the concept of abiogenesis. Please stay to the end of this video because, inshallah, the information will be very beneficial. So if you remember, in the last video we discussed abiogenesis, what abiogenesis is and some of the theories surrounding it. Abiogenesis has really been developed as a requirement to, because Darwin's book was actually called On the Origin of Species, but didn't actually deal with the origin of species. It kind of dealt with species, or a theory about species, once they developed. So the origin of species is something that abiogenesis was developed to actually deal with. And abiogenesis, as we mentioned previously, has a lot of issues, or the concept of abiogenesis has a lot of issues. And one of those issues is chirality. So what is chirality? Now, before I start, I studied electronics, I didn't study chemistry. And I want to tell a quick story before I continue, just to humble myself. I spent from the year 1997 until 2013 as an engineer, except for five of those years when I was working in the field of electronics. All of the other years, I was basically acquiring data sets on oil rigs and gas rigs and energy sites. And one of the main surveys that I would do is called a seismic survey. Basically, when you collect the data, you have to process the data. So us as field engineers, we wouldn't process the data. We would make sure the data was properly quality controlled and we'd hand it over. Now, once we handed it over to the processors, they would typically carry out something called migration on the data set. It's a form of processing that allows you to interpret the data. And you can see the subsurface reflectors in their actual place and kind of what they should actually look like. And I remember when I was going for one of my promotions, I wrote a paper on migration, and I had to do a lot of research and try and understand what it was and how it worked and relate it to the data I used to acquire. And once I finished, I mean, it was hard work and it took a lot of thinking and effort, but once I finished, I was so proud of it. And I gave this paper to the main processing chief in the facility in Bahrain at the time. And I asked him to read the paper for me. So I came back the next day, I said, what did you think? What did you think? And he goes, yeah, it's good. I mean, but it's very basic. So there was me thinking, because personally I'd made a breakthrough in understanding this, but actually a lot of people do it for a living and it's very, very, my level of understanding was very, very low compared to theirs. So I'm acutely aware of the fact that that's the case in what I'm about to tell you. Although, the amount of research I've done to understand to get to the point where I am, I'm pretty sure that it will be beneficial for me to share some of that with you guys, inshallah ta'ala. So there's two areas I want to mention with regards to chirality. The first one is one that I'm much more familiar with, and that's in terms of quantum physics. And when we talk about particles and the spin of particles, it's a bit difficult to explain. I don't really want to dilute this video by talking about quantum mechanical spin. But quantum mechanical particles, if we talk about electrons, for example, have a spin. They can have a spin which is left or right-handed. And one thing which I found out very recently, actually, which is extraordinarily interesting, is regards to the Higgs field, you know, the Higgs boson, but the Higgs field. An electron, as it goes through its life, changes its spin from left to right and right to left all the time. And what they discovered, the scientists, was that left-handed electrons have a little something extra that right-handed electrons don't. And that's known as the weak hypercharge. Now, this weak hypercharge allows left-handed electrons to feel the weak nuclear force, whereas right-handed electrons cannot. And this is known in science as something called a parity violation. So now I've reached the limit, so I'm going to quickly read this. The weak hypercharge must be ditched in order for the electron to become right-handed, and it has to be picked up again in order for it to become left-handed. So where does the charge come from and go to? Well, you might have guessed, it's the Higgs field. The Higgs field has a positive strength everywhere in the universe, and the electron feels its mass from this interaction with the Higgs field. Isn't that incredible? SubhanAllah. Look at the precise nature of everything in the universe that we're finding out. Anyway, so this is basically an example of chirality in electrons. They can have a spin in one direction or another. when we talk about chirality in terms of chemistry, which is basically as it relates to abiogenesis, so I'm going to read from my son's chemistry book. A good analogy is to look at your left and right hands. They are exactly the opposite of each other, but cannot lie on top of another and align perfectly. I'll show you an image here to give you a rough idea of it. And these are called optical isomers. Optical isomerism occurs when a molecule has a chiral center. That is to say, it has a carbon atom that is connected to four different atoms or groups of atoms. So each carbon atom is known as a chiral center because it can connect to four other atoms. And that's really, really important because each chiral carbon can have two possible isomers, a left-handed or a right-handed. So if you have a molecule with two carbon centers, that means it's 2^2, so four. And then if you've got three, it's 2^3. And if you've got four, it's 2^4, and so on. Optical isomers have identical chemical properties, except when they interact with something that is also chiral. For example, apart from glycine, which is the 20th amino acid, all naturally occurring amino acids have optical isomers, which means that all the proteins in our body are chiral. So different types of chiral molecules, whether they're left or right, can interact with proteins in a different way because they're also chiral. And something which I found flabbergasting, because you may have heard of the thalidomide disaster that happened many years ago in the 1960s. Again, this was in my son's chemistry book. An important application of optical isomerism is the synthesis of pharmaceutical drugs. You might have heard of the thalidomide tragedy. Back in the 1960s in Germany, the molecule B shown in this picture was found to have anti-nausea effects and was therefore used to treat morning sickness in pregnant women. Unfortunately, molecule B was being manufactured together with its optical isomer. So this is very important. When they were creating a solution, or this drug in its solution, or however they created it, they were creating a molecule. But actually what happened was, because of this thing called chirality or optical isomerism, its opposite molecule also, its right and its left-handed molecules were also created. And the scientists, they didn't realize this. Unfortunately, molecule B was being manufactured together with its optical isomer A, and little was known about molecule A until many children born in that era were found to have deformed limbs. These days, many drug companies devote a great deal of money to separating optical isomers of new drugs just in case they have side effects. So you can see the importance here, and I hope you're starting to see the picture of why this is important in abiogenesis. So, point number one, chirality is important to abiogenesis because nature favours the production of molecules in what we call a racemic state, so a mixture of optical isomers. It doesn't naturally produce left or right-handed, it produces an equal mixture of both. This is called a racemic mixture. SubhanAllah, the amazing thing is, in the body, what we find is all of the amino acids, with the exception of glycine, are left-handed. None of them are right-handed, they're all left-handed. And the interesting thing about this is, and this is, I saw this on a video once, a very nice explanation. So is it just us that have left-handed, and maybe birds have right-handed, or they have a mixture? No. Imagine if you eat a chicken, and that chicken has right-handed amino acids. Right-handed doesn't mix very well with left-handed, and all sorts of nasty things can happen, as you saw with the thalidomide disaster. So everything in nature, pretty much, in terms of amino acids, has to be left-handed. So how did this happen? How did left-handed amino acids become the amino acids of choice in everything, not right-handed or a mixture of both? So the challenge for origin of life researchers is to figure out, from a racemic mixture, how does nature, without any guidance or knowledge or push or anything, create a homochiral fluid or set of molecules, such as left-handed amino acids, that then go on to be used in all of nature. I'm going to read and put the definitions of those words I just mentioned, because I just learned them myself. Racemic is a mixture that has equal amounts of left and right-handed enantiomers of a chiral molecule. Homochiral is when all molecules of a substance comprise the same enantiomer. And an enantiomer is one of two stereoisomers that are mirror images of each other and that are not superimposable. So what I did was I just wrote them down, and I keep referring to this because that's how I familiarize myself with the terms. It's not that difficult. They're just long words that mean something. So you just have to kind of get your head around it, and it starts to make sense. But it also gets a little bit more complicated than that, because ribonucleotides apparently have 16 different chiralities, and sucrose has 512. And some of these are building blocks for these are building blocks for DNA. So the problem just gets multiplied as you keep looking at it. It's just exponentially more difficult as you go through it. Now, I've seen some papers, especially talking about the SOI technique, requires chemistry that is pretty much non-representative of prebiotic or the situation that would be present on the early Earth. And I've actually seen Origin of Life researchers state that the output of this SOI reaction doesn't give you the volume of molecules required, you know, the excess of molecules required to give you something which could then get, you know, exponentially bigger, such as a left-handed or a right-handed homochiral molecule. There is a 2004 paper by Kojo and some of his colleagues, I believe the Japanese, on racemic asparagine causing enantiomeric excess of amino acids during recrystallization. The problem with that is it's a very low yield, and the quantities of asparagine used were extremely high, disproportionately high. So it's a very, very low efficiency reaction. Quite a lot of details there, a little bit heavy, but basically, as far as I've researched so far, there are no representative prebiotic techniques that have been figured out which would result in homochiral amino acids being formed. There's a really good 13-part series by a guy called Dr. James Tor. He did 13 videos on homochirality, kind of in response to another guy's video about him, and a little bit of back and forth. But the videos are quite beneficial. He goes through things in detail. You know, and if you're interested in this, I suggest you check those out. He talks about something called chirality-induced spin selectivity, which is pretty high-level stuff, but it is very interesting. It's kind of a mixture between quantum mechanics and chemistry. It's all interlinked at the end of the day, but I did find that very, very interesting. I'm still trying to wrap my head around it. The thumbnail, actually from this video, which I'll put up here, is actually taken from the website that contains the information about this chirally induced spin selectivity phenomenon, which is really, really interesting if you are that interested to delve into the details. Unfortunately, I am. I do like the details. I find them fascinating, and that's something which we all have to be careful for, because the materialist camp are absolutely hell-bent on proving a naturalist, no God scenario. They start with that as a substrate, and everything has to be built on that. So if you bring God, you know, a creator, into this scenario, it doesn't fit onto their substrate. They have no space for it. And there's a lot of politics, a lot of economics, you know, all involved in this equation. It can get quite fierce. If you've looked around YouTube, you can see a lot of savagery from the materialistic camp. And also, unfortunately, some of our brothers get caught up in the furore, and sometimes respond back quite aggressively. And this is what they want. Strongly advise against it. Take a step back. Don't send that comment. You know, don't send that comment on the group. It's better to just be the better person. But at the end of the day, it's very important to remember that our belief is based on the Quran and the Sunnah, the Nabuwa of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, his life, SubhanAllah, I mean, this is what our belief is based on. You know, the Quran is the miracle that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent to us. So our belief is based on this. I'm doing these videos really to just to try and help people to understand the noise, and that, you know, it should, most of this, the posturing by the materialist camp is just that, it's just posturing. They're just beating their chests and acting arrogant in order to try and trick you into thinking that they actually know what's going on when they don't. Science has a long history of that, which a lot of people have gone into in other videos. Anyway, I hope this video was beneficial to you and it made some kind of sense. It's a very tricky topic, but it's really, really interesting. A bit of a niche video. I'm not sure how many people will watch it, but anyway, please like and subscribe and have a look at the other videos on this playlist. And also on my channel, and please feel free to interact with me in the comments. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.